smart contracts and why Haskell is particularly relevant to Haskell smart contracts. So my main claim is that in the future we are going to write smart contracts very differently from the way we write them today. Today we do them in Ethereum in Solidity directly. I believe that that is too low level, and we're going to do contracts at a higher level and then compile it to Ethereum. So that's my basic premise. So, you know, prior to last month, nobody really knew about this or cared about this. And then suddenly there was this, the DAO thing. You guys have all heard about this, right? Yeah, okay. And somebody, you know, ran off with a few million dollars worth of Ethereum. And that got people very interested in the security of smart contracts. This was the message from the attacker. Very clever and slightly snarky, just the way I like it. And so people said, you know, it turns out that Ethereum and the DAO have turned into the world's largest bug bounty program. So that was pretty funny. And a few days after that, Vitalik was like, okay, now we need to think about security. This is the funny thing about all software, right? The life cycle of products is functionality, reliability, convenience, price, right? You compete on these frontiers. Functionality, reliability, convenience, and then price. And none of these frontiers are about security. So we sort of shoehorn security into a system that we've already built. And that's the way things always will be. Because if you have two products, one of them cares about functionality first and is insecure, that's the one people are going to use. If you have another product that cares about security first and functionality second, nobody's going to use that. So this is just part of the human condition. Ever since the Garden of Eden, we've had to make this particular compromise. So Vitalik has gone and listed a number of classes of bugs that you can exploit in Ethereum. And if you take a step back and look at like why these bugs exist, right? And now people are saying, gosh, we need to have formal correctness. But why did these bugs happen in the first place? Software developers come from a culture where move fast and break things, right? Like, what's the worst that could happen? You write some code, and then you load the web page, and the web page doesn't quite work, so you go back and you write the code again, and then it works the second time. You're like, all right, I fixed it. And if you're really responsible, you're like, okay, I'm going to check it on my phone now before I decide that it actually works. And it's like, oh, it works on my phone. Okay, let's commit. And then somebody else says, oh, it doesn't work on Android. And you're like, oh, well, go and raise a bug report. Right? So that's the way people are. And that culture of software development has given us a world in which everything sucks all the time. Sometimes it's Amazon, like, losing $66,000 a minute. Sometimes it's, like, the Japanese spacecraft that just went up last year, this year.
What was that?
Hmm?
That shouldn't have happened.
What should have
happened? I mean, that's solved.
It should be solved in theory, right?
Did the Japanese just fuck it up?
They fucked up.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Like, even the Japanese can fuck this up. They blew 286 million, right? So the DAO is like, that's only 100 million. Or, you know, like a bunch of people died because back in the 80s, there was this life-critical computerized radiation therapy, and like, it went wrong and it delivered 200,000 rads to this poor individual. And this happened several times. And so, you know, the list goes on. The Mars Climate Orbiter is another example of how software screws up. And that's 120. Right? So it's like one DAO's worth of screw up.
The entire field of neuroscience, it turns out that someone found
it. No, that was different. It wasn't a bug. That was an incorrect assumption about Gaussianity.
So he has a PhD in MRI, so we'll get Rachel to talk about
it. It was a flawed assumption, not a bug.
But look, like, there are all these bugs, right? And like baggage handling, they can't get it right. So So you could go through and read this entire list of bugs. It's like pretty entertaining. And you would think that even the space guys would get it right, but sometimes they don't. So there's, like, you would think there are better ways to write software than this. And even Facebook is like, we need better ways to write software. So there are a number of solutions that the world has come up with. Like, at the bottom of the stack, Raygun, these guys, they're like, you're going to have bugs, and we're going to help you detect your bugs. So, and when your program crashes, we're going to find the crashes. So that's nice, right? But that's like, when your spacecraft crashes, we will tell you that your spacecraft crashed. It's like, okay, great, that's great, but how do we fix that ahead of time? And there are companies like Coverity that got by Synopsys, and they help to prove that your Pentium doesn't have a floating point bug, for example. And they do what's called static analysis. Is there anybody here who's familiar with static analysis? Okay, three people. Okay, good. This is why there are bugs out there, right? So, like, reliability, verification, static analysis, this is a thing. And typically this is used for situations where once you've burned your code into the CPU, you can't upgrade the CPU. So they do it for hardware, for chips. Sometimes they do it for spacecraft. And Reddit is beginning to discover that maybe we should start using some of these techniques with Ethereum and finance software. And there's a great long thread up here where somebody summarizes like how these things don't work, how they're supposed to work, right? And the language itself guarantees that there are no bugs. And I can give you a really quick tour of some of the approaches and some of the ways to solve these problems. Like, for example, these guys are saying lots of Ethereum contracts ignore best practice recommendations, therefore you get this kind of bug. And how do you avoid these bugs? You can just not have the bug. And so they have gone and written a reviewer of all of the live contracts in the blockchain to try to identify this class of bugs. So that's kind of cool, right? Imagine being able to just look at all the contracts that are in the blockchain and find the buggy ones, and then you can exploit that. That could be your full-time job. So here's their automated analysis. Pretty cool. I think it's a sign that we need a different approach. So just like manually saying, here's the best practice, let's not write that bug. Humans are way too fallible to do it this way, right? So this is a Haskell meetup, you're all Haskell programmers and you love types and you think there is a better way. So these people just put out a master's thesis on how to do safer smart contracts through type-driven development. Exactly what you would think, right? So Haskell is the way, or Haskell is kind of the approach. Here's another paper that just came out this month. Logic-based smart contracts for blockchain systems. So clearly there's a trend of thought in this direction. Okay. So is this interesting? Am I losing anyone yet? I'm just reviewing what I've discovered. So there's actually a strain of this work that goes back several years, even before the DAO, even before Ethereum. People have been thinking about smart contracts, just in terms of like real world contracts. How do we, like, banks have option agreements and derivative contracts? These are actual contracts and they're electronic, even if they're not on the blockchain, they're real. So people have been thinking about this for a long time. And I think there's a good opportunity to connect the dots between these kinds of academic papers and the kinds of bugs that you're seeing in the real world and the approach that Haskell programmers are instinctively used to. So, what kind of software does not have bugs? There's only one kind of software that doesn't have bugs, and it's called math. Are there any mathematicians in the room?
There are some funny exceptions.
That's true. But generally speaking, it's like if you can prove mathematically that your program does what it's supposed to do, then you have a leg up on top of the people who don't do that kind of proof. And that's why mathematicians are smug. You know, when I was an undergrad doing computer science, we were always terrified of the physicists. And the physicists were always terrified of mathematicians. So I think that's just how it is. And, you know, translate that to software. I think this is the hierarchy of smugness. Is this roughly correct? Is this what you tend to think too? Like Haskell programmers are like morally superior to Java programmers. And then, you know, the JavaScript guys, they're like, okay, but they're morally superior to the C programmers, for example, because it's higher level, right? But it turns out that Haskell is only just like halfway up this hierarchy. Does anybody here program in Agda or Idris or Coq? Has anybody here heard of Coq?
So,
yes.
I played with either, but I honestly cannot tell that I did really program in them.
Okay.
Because the proving part of these systems is so complicated, actually writing a decent, complex system takes a long time.
That's right.
I would
That's
say
right.
that the documentation for those systems is a process, but they make perfect sense.
Maybe what we need is a proof playground.
Yeah, but
Yeah.
Good idea. So, no, I just want to make you aware that proving something correct is much different from exploring whether there is something that could work, or even demonstrating that it could possibly work. Because design space is potentially infinite, and before you do anything that you can prove, you first need to have something working.
Well, I don't want to.
Go on.
So, I think what the formal method community has learned over the years, maybe last 30, is the idea of what's called post-mortem proofs. You write your program and then you try to prove that it's doing what it's doing. This is really brute force, difficult, very hard to scale up. And it's much more efficient approach to actually design the program, improve hand in hand. A mathematician will tell you the way you set up your definitions is half the work to do the proof. And the definitions, that's the program of stuff. And so, for example, at NICTA, there's the world's first verified microkernel, you may have heard of that. It's called SEL4, if you want to type that in. And exactly that. And the way this proof was done was actually implementing the kernel in Haskell first. Why? Because that implementation allowed to play around with the system, but then abstract that declarative kind of specification into, in that case, the proof was done with Isabel, into the Isabel formalization and derive manually by recoding the Haskell to C and efficient microkernel. And that way the two could be made up. And that's the reason why that was the first successful verification of the operating system. It's not that other people tried, but they always tried for some other.
But it,
so
you
it
also
needs to
you
be
also tell that there was a prototype.
Yeah, but the prototype.
And most programs ever end at the stage of prototypes in a way. You have to prove that something can work and you are happy with it.
But the prototype was done with the proof in mind.
This is secure design, for example. The techniques to secure the whole thing. If you did not start with your proof, you can't get above it.
Yeah.
Period. If you're trying to get specific cryptography or aerospace use, you literally can't get a high level certification. You start with code and then try to do it. You actually got to start with definition of invariance first and then build a code, because you otherwise end up in a, you've got running code.
that's a great thing about ACTA. ACTA lets you scale. You can write basically Haskell program in ACTA, and then you iteratively you make the types more and more precise. And in that way, the type is the proof. The type is the theorem, but the proof is the program in ACTA. And you, by making types more rigorous, you can be more and more formal, and the proof be covering more and more. That's the beauty about those opinions.
So there's a whole book about this in ACTA. So if you're attracted by this whole idea, you can read this book and get stumped by it. But I want to focus on one thing that you said. The type is the theorem and the proof is the program. Has anybody heard of this idea before? So this idea is called the Curry-Howard isomorphism. And the Curry-Howard isomorphism relates the lambda calculus to functional programming. Right? That's the reason we all have lambdas. It's like people picked this random Greek letter and they're like, let's have anonymous functions be lambdas. So let me go back to, real quick, let me go back to where we were, right? So this hierarchy of smugness is actually a projection from the lambda cube. Have you heard of the lambda cube? So the lambda cube is basically like basic lambda functional programming languages over here. And then you start adding features, and you add features, and you add features, and then you end up with something that is extremely morally superior, and like way more smug. So, for example, cock is a proof assistant. This is what mathematicians use to write proofs, right? And then they're like, you know, we use cock because Haskell is too low level for us. In fact, what we do is we compile cock to Haskell. So they start all the way up on the top right of the cube, and then they extract your OCaml or your Haskell program. And this is how you eventually turn it into C, and then you've got your verified microkernel or your spaceship or whatever you want to do. Start the proof, then turn it into program, and then you turn it into actual machine code. And along the way, you can witness that all these things maintain provable correctness. Another random thing that I came across was Z notation. So this is a language that you use to specify behavior rather than implement behavior. Most of what we do is implementation. If you can start with the specification, you should be able to extract an implementation from it. So this is, again, super math work. In theory, you can start with Z and then pull things out of it. So, really high level stuff. ACTA, Idris, and the Curry-Howard correspondence. This is the big idea, is start the lambda calculus and you end up with functional programming. So keep this in mind because I'm going to come back to it. So, different programming languages. Actually, let me do this in here. So different programming languages have different kinds of properties, right? You can say, if we had a language with static types and we wanted it to support functional and object programming, then that program would be, the programming language would be OCaml. And if all you got is like imperative programming, then you've got assembly language. If you've got logic programming, you get Prolog. So this is kind of my quick list of different kinds of programming languages and the kinds of paradigms that they support. And if the paradigm is functional, well, functional corresponds to the lambda calculus. If you want to use the actor model, like Erlang, that actually has a different calculus. That's called the Pi calculus, or the process calculus. And I believe, my assertion is that to do contract programming, and we're coming up with this language called L4, we're coming up with a new model of programming called contract programming or deontic programming, and the underlying calculus for that is the mu calculus. So there's a lot of Greek, it's all Greek to me. There's the lambda calculus, functional, the pi calculus, which gets you actor, and then the mu calculus, which gets you deontic. So this is the Curry-Howard correspondence as a translation function from an underlying calculus to a programming paradigm, to a programming language. Does that make sense to everyone? You should be very comfortable with lifting and like high level abstractions. So that's kind of where I'm at right now. Has anybody read this paper? This is one of the original Curry Howard correspondence papers back in 1965. This guy said, you know, looking at Algol, writing code in Algol, kind of feels like writing math using Lambda, and maybe these things are related. And it turns out that Algol supports the Lambda calculus. Lisp also took this idea. So let me zoom out from the whole calculus programming language thing for a minute. Even back before Ethereum, back before the DAO, people have been talking about how to write computable contracts. Just general purpose, like real world contracts. I'm going to rent an apartment, or I'm going to sell you a thing and you're going to buy a thing, or we're going to do an investment agreement for a startup. These kinds of contracts, whether or not they live on the blockchain, it should be possible to represent them computationally. This guy's called Balaji, and Balaji has been saying, you know, maybe we should go and computerize all this stuff. Let's encode simple business contracts before we do DAOs, so that we get the foundations right. So that's kind of an interesting idea, right? At Stanford, they've been thinking about this. They have the Computable Contracts Project, and they've been saying, you know, we need to start with the language, and then we need verification, and then we need analysis and implementation. So how do we extract a real-world contract out of contract description language? So all these ideas are out there. And so in the legal domain, in legal tech, you get this equivalent XKCD. And again, it ends up in mathematics. And so what is this mu calculus, right? We know what the lambda calculus is. The mu calculus, the modal calculus, deals with I'll just let you read this because it makes more sense.
What's the distinction between deontic logic and the mu calculus?
So the deontic logic is one application of the mu calculus. If you look at the calculus, it has the box operator and it has the diamond operator. And in the case of a deontic application of the new calculus, box means you must do something and the diamond means you can do something. It's possible to do other forms of a modal calculus, such as a temporal. So let's see. So temporal logic, where time is your world. It's like, I am always hungry is your box. And then I will become hungry at some point in the future is your diamond. So this is another application. So you want deontics. So let me open up deontics. So deontic logic is relevant to contracts because you say somebody must do something or somebody may do something. And that is the basis for your calculus. You can say somebody must not do something. Somebody must do something, somebody must not do something. Right? That's your negation. To say that somebody may do something is equivalent to saying that it's not true that somebody must not do something. So that's your not, which turns into permission. Right, so this is a different calculus that lets you think about what you are supposed to do. And in both cases, both the temporal and the deontic logics make use of crypt-key semantics.
How do you capture the mutual obligation?
Right, so I must do something and you must do something, right? I pay you some money and you give me a thing.
But each obligation extends, well no, because it's not, they're not naked, they're not naked, undertaking. So each
So it is, it turns out that it is possible to model this, right? It's like A has to be true and B has to be true, else you have some sort of breach or reparation scenario. So let's look at, so this is, I'm just introducing the idea of a modal logic being the basis for some kind of contract language, right? In the same way that the lambda calculus is the basis for functional programming, I think the modal new calculus will be the basis for contract programming. And that is the piece that's missing from Ethereum, the DAO, and sort of today's software. They're all basically doing the equivalent of assembly and JavaScript, when they should be doing the equivalent of Haskell and Coq. So, lots of Greek. I put the Greek down here. So that's kind of my argument. Where was I? So, okay. So, so very recently, people have been doing PhDs on this. So this PhD just came out a few years ago. Contract formalization and DSS. So very exciting. And he uses a variant of deontic logic to represent obligation, because that's the core expression. And this is what a contract is. Basically, if you want to encode contracts, then you say a clause in a contract is either trivially fulfilled or, this is the big one, under some circumstance, some actor has to perform some action within a certain amount of time. And if they do that, then you recursively go to a different clause. And if they fail to do it, then you recursively go to a failure clause. So this is the logic. I'll just let you read this.
So if you go back, maybe I will explain the modalities that you
said
there.
Let's just read this paragraph first. So that everybody gets the English language version. And then, if you want to explain the modalities, how does, where's the modal logic?
So basically, you see here is the fragment of just a normal logic, positional logic, which means that you have and or. I don't see. Oh, there is also this expression, the negation, yeah, and variables. So that's pretty much apparent that it works the same way. And then these logical statements can be embedded in the modal statements on top. So we have either fulfillment, so the contract has been satisfied, or the obligation, so something has to be done by somebody until certain time. Or two types of choices. One is that you make the choice or contract makes the choice. So if the amount due is more than $1,000, then you give the receipt, otherwise maybe not. And there is external choice, which means that somebody else makes a choice and you need to adapt to it. So you need to give somebody a choice. It's like with options on the financial markets, that you can have an option that gives you right to have a choice, or the other way. And again, there is the temporal aspect, which means that something happens either after a certain time or meanwhile from one point to the other. Yeah.
So this relates both deontics and temporal modals in this language. And the claim is that this language is sufficient to take any real-world contract and translate it into a formalism that can be proved. And you can take your real-world contract, formalize it, and then say, here are all the bugs in your contract. It is not a total contract, because there are so many code paths where you just have like a null pointer, or it's undefined. Right? And I'm sure we've all read contracts where it's like, we're going to do something, and you're going to do something, and that's your happy path. And there's no exception handling. And if it fails, you just breach, right? And then you have a lawsuit. So if we can have better exception handling in contracts, we're like, I do something, you're supposed to do something, and if you don't do that something, then we actually handle that scenario, then there are going to be fewer lawsuits, right? Really simple. So all of this stuff is actually available on the internet. So the guys who did this contract specification language have all of this done in Haskell. So it's all there. What we want to do next is take this basic language and see if we can compile it to Ethereum. We want to see if we can prove it in something that's closer to AGDA. I mean, this AGDA and Haskell are actually very close, so maybe we can upgrade this to AGDA and then we can verify it. So we want to compile it to Ethereum, we want to run formal proofs, and we also want to compile it to English. So there's this thing called Attempto Controlled English. And Attempto Controlled English is a formal language. Which means that there should be some kind of Turing equivalence between your contract written in Haskell or AGDA and this English language contract. So you should be able to extract lengthy legalese from L4. Does that make sense? And if you can extract it to English, you should also be able to extract it to Chinese. Right? Starting with the same source code. And then it becomes really cool to have bilingual contracts, because that is a multi-billion dollar industry itself. If you want to do business across country boundaries, you usually have to have multiple languages. So this is something that, like, Europe should get excited about. So these are the goals of the project. We want to write this DSL, the extension of the what we've just looked at. We want to do formal methods on it. We want to turn it into English, other languages, and we want to turn it into Ethereum. So that's kind of the project, and I'm putting this out there because, you know, I think that if all of this is possible, then in the future, this is how people are going to write contracts. And I open it up to discussion. Does this make sense? Can you poke any holes in this argument? Does it sound like nonsense? Or do you know of anything that makes all of this, like, irrelevant or obsolete or wrong? Or not even wrong? Because if we're not wrong, then in a few years, probably, contracts will be written in this. And that's going to be the bulk of smart contract development, both on the blockchain and off the blockchain. It's only a few years away, just like AI.
Next thing.
So in your opinion, that's the migration, like, from the existing, like, real-world contract will be a smooth migration to the Ethereum formal language contract, because for, like, for example, the JavaScript and somebody trying to compile some better language to JavaScript, and but people still might not use the those better language to, but instead use the, like, most language. Like,
yeah, the thing that will really encourage them to get it right is that we'll be able to find their bugs and exploit them, basically.
Uh-huh.
So, yeah,
until a lawyer gets upset and finds political, legislative, or other means to shut it down. Several kinds of lawyers.
Yes. So, the question was, what happens when the lawyers decide that we are intruding on their business?
Yeah.
So
I think it's less relevant, because the lawyer business is not about writing contracts itself. About providing certain quality and assurance about consistency with the law. So
no.
Judgmental part can be a separate topic, whether it's consistent with Singapore law.
Typical law firm billings. Your assertion may not be correct.
Yeah, like, look at a law firm, right? A law firm is really wedded to the idea of doing all this stuff by hand. Why? Because the corporate side, right, they've got a whole bunch of lawyers writing contracts. And then they have an equal number number of lawyers doing dispute resolution. And there is a correlation between these facts.
So to a certain extent, I think you will have an easier time with smart contracts like Ethereum or something like that, because the interface problem basically, I mean, obviously, it's definitely possible to have a DSL in Haskell or whatever and compile to Ethereum. I mean, I'm not saying it's easy, but it's clear it can be done, and because the contracts in the blockchain are the contract and there's nothing else, I think it's clear that this is possible. The question is how hard is it? With the real world contracts, the problem is the interface. So the contract doesn't live in a void, but for example, translating contracts between Chinese and English, the problem is the contract will in China will be interpreted in the context of Chinese law, and in Singapore, Australia, wherever, interpreted in that nation's legal context, which will be different. So the same thing will mean different things. That's actually, I mean, taking your correlate or your the analogy you played with formal methods a step further, that is actually a problem that formal methods also encounters within the formal software. Everything is clear because everything is specified and so on. But then, for example, take L4, the verified microcode. It is really, I mean, as far as the specification goes, this thing is not going to go wrong, 100% sure. There's not a single bug in the implementation. But the operating system needs to be booted. Oh, but nobody verified the bootloader. And how about bugs in the hardware and so on? And I think with legal contracts, which are not in a smart contract environment, you get the same. I'm not saying this is breaking the idea, but it will create friction where you have to interact with non-formalized things because, well, that happens to be the law in the country and it's written however it's written.
Yeah, and we see exactly this this idea even in the tradition of law, where some countries have a constitution and they have legislation, and other countries just have common law and case law, right? And so one is more formal than the other.
Yeah.
And you can put these things on a spectrum. But I think it is also possible for people to say, look, we as private parties choose to subscribe to this infrastructure as opposed to that infrastructure. In the same way that a lot of people choose to run Linux or OS X or Windows, right? You choose your operating system. And so it may be possible to just import like enough libraries to basically have your own private set of a private interface layer that abstracts away the underlying country, right? It becomes a localization problem, internationalization problem. So I think that might happen in the future. Who knows? It's possible to use L4 to write contracts. It's also possible to use L4 to write regulations.
Creative Commons already does this. Version 2 of their licenses, they were doing open licenses to each jurisdiction. Version 3, they thought, that's way too complicated. Version 4, I think. Version 8. So they've written a high level license for each of the 5 cases, 6 cases, whatever. And then they're basically doing a prefix. Here's how this translates to US, UK, Singapore, Australia, Germany.
That's right. So, you know, implementing a contract for a particular jurisdiction basically is another import line in your module. So, you know, there are, if you look at what legislation actually looks like, you see variable definitions, you see function calls, you see anonymous functions, you see if-then-else case statements, right? And all of this stuff looks exactly like something that you want to put curly braces around or give it some indentation and just turn it into a function with proper types, right? This is something that actually goes back a long, long ways. So if you go back to 1986, the Nationality Act, that basically says, are you a citizen? Depends on whether your parents were citizens, where were you born? Were you born in a country that was a British colony at the time when you were born? Right? So they wrote a prologue program to solve for whether someone is a British national in 1986. So it should be possible to apply this kind of thinking to smart contracts, Haskell, 30 years later. Right? So any other thoughts, comments? Is anybody interested in working with us on this, whose day job doesn't prohibit them from doing so? So we are, there's a very small team of people working on this project, legalese.com.
I have a question.
Yeah.
Do you think that the DAO hacker should keep his money?
Yeah.
I think so. Yeah, actually, I do think so.
Yeah. Who here thinks that the DAO hacker should not be able to keep his money? Who here thinks that the DAO hacker should keep this money? Right, you're all like strongly into rule of law.
I would say I'm in the third camp. I have serious doubt whether it's enforceable for taking his money away from him. The first, it's totally virtual. It's all in ethers.
Mm-hmm.
And the second thing, it has been contracted, so.
I think there are also instances where the regulators are intentionally keeping their laws vague.
Yeah.
All right. So they, yeah, they do not really want to be clear on everything.
The
regulators
in the EU issue. It should really be a toggle between the two.
The EU generates directives to member states to transpose legislation, and it's quite explicit the intention to maintain room for maneuver. And be specific.
Exactly.
Intended to make sure that the directives sort of point where they want to go, but with enough ambiguity that the political processes in each country can run with a bit of room for.
So they can never be formally verified.
So
in many countries, there is also the obligation on the part of either the parliament or the whoever issues the legal act and the judge that before any interpretation or any specifics, there is the intent of the law declared. And in many jurisdictions, the fact that intent has ceased to matter means that the executive act in many cases. This is very, very important in some legal.
Well, I suspect Brussels is going to learn this later this year, but certainly what tends to be inequitable is that lower courts can't consider intent where they've got clear and ambiguous instructions of the kind that appear in the
that may be
here.
Common law, because it's based on the custom, but if you go into the civil law, like in most of European countries, that's enough.
Once you step a couple of levels of review higher, then it becomes permissible and potentially obligatory to look at whether the black letter law as written implements the intent of the legislature. So the US Supreme Court spends all its time on that, the UK Council of Law, so it can be interpreting the news that I've been fifty short, spend a fair bit of time. get to a point where like, okay, now we look at does this instrument achieve what the legislators were trying to achieve? But that's a whole, that's my other perhaps answer to your question about what might unstick this mean. That the we are so dependent on a bunch of assumptions about how much a judiciary can undo when it becomes apparent that something won't go quite to plan, that large sudden changes of scope likely to cause difficulties. And those difficulties might turn into unenforceability, or they might turn into markets recoiling terror or whatever. But it's hard to guess how that plays. And this is software engineering.
So, I don't want to get too far into philosophy, but you can, I think, I'm going to suggest a couple of ideas. Are there any philosophers in the room who can explain to me the difference between intentionality and extensionality? If not, I will just make up my answer, which is that extensional logic has to do with things that are like objectively evident in the real world. So it's like we can say I have a dollar and I'm going to hand you a dollar. And intentional logic sort of has to do with things that are not quite so obvious and not quite so objective. So we might say intentionally I am an immoral person, or I am guilty, or I will be guilty at some point in the future. Right? These are less objective ideas. And so what we're really saying with the DAO attacker is, a lot of people would say, look, even if the DAO attacker keeps his money, I am not going to deal with this person. I am going to shun that person because I don't want to take their money because these are ill-gotten gains. And that takes us all the way back to like the 17th century Amish who decide that they don't want to interact with this person, right? And that's a kind of intentional consequence, right? The attacker got the money, that's an extensional truth. But nobody likes the attacker, and that's an intentional result. And by trying to tweak the DAO and appeal to Vitalik and like basically hack Ethereum so that we can undo this, we're trying to translate an intentional situation to an extensional situation. My proposal is that, if you think about it, on Medium everybody can have their own blog, right? On YouTube everybody can have their own TV channel. My proposal is that everybody should have their own currency, which is not such a crazy idea. If you think about it, like the stock market, every publicly traded company has their own currency, right? And it's like whatever your share something is. So if it's possible for every publicly traded company to have its own currency, if it's possible for every country to have its own currency, then why shouldn't every individual have their own currency? And the consequence for the DAO attacker is that even though they can make off with like $20 million worth of Ethereum, so the exchange rate suddenly goes like this, and all of the Ethereum that they have converted to their personal currency is now worthless, and all of the value stays in the original currency. That is, I think, the crypto way to relate intentional to extension without having to go and hack the DAO.
So you can only spend your own currency?
You can spend your own currency, and you can trade your currency with people who are willing to trade with you. So it'll be like those lame PGP key parties, right? Like in the blockchain. And the state that you live in, the fiat currency, might be legally obliged to trade with you. So you always have, like, if you're a nation of, if you're a national of some country, then you have to be able to interconvert with Singapore dollars. So that might be one future scenario. But we're kind of getting a little far away from smart contracts, but I think that is the right long-term solution.
Well, but that's, you asked about things that could derail the doing. That's
okay.
We sort of unintentionally construct a system that consistently renders profoundly unjust outcomes invisibly, profoundly unjust outcomes in the system itself, which so it's not positive, it's more expensive. It's really important that we're in the second place.
Speak up.
Where are the safety valves? How does the thing?
I don't know.
suggested one really strong one is that you move the resolution out to the willingness of society to individuals to accept the fruits of that person achieve, rather than attack the logic of the system that everything else is built upon. There are others, but I think that's a good one.
Yep. So while I'm doing this like wild crypto anarchy excursion, I'm gonna recommend that everybody go check this out. Moneyhasdebt.net. This is fundamentally like everybody that I've spoken to about this has not found a way to deny the fundamental fact that if you have a system in which interest exists, right? Imagine a closed world. There are 10 individuals. And then there is the bank. And the individuals go to the bank. They say, we want to borrow some money. And we'll give it back to you after 1 year. And the bank says, great, we're going to do 10% interest. After 1 year, it's logical, I can logically guarantee that one of those people has to go bankrupt. Right? Because it's a closed system.
Because I haven't responded. We don't live in a closed system.
Hmm?
We don't live in a closed system.
Well, the world is in fact a closed system, like the globe.
It has gigawatts of energy.
That's true.
Entering the system.
And we are not able to model that correctly with money, right? Because the monetary system that we have actually, like, when they borrow money, the bank actually creates most of that money out of nothing. That's fractional reserve banking. And then somebody has to pay back that money. And not everybody can pay back 10% interest because that money doesn't exist. And so every so often, Greece will go bankrupt, individuals go bankrupt, banks need to get bailed out. And the only solution is if, on average, banks charge 5% interest, then the global economy, GDP, has to go up by 5% every year, or people go bankrupt. So this is another like fundamental issue that I think we're going to have to stop thinking about. It's like the people who designed the system didn't really think it through.
They assumed there was a way that they envisioned that there was scope to go everywhere else.
Yeah. So, like thousands of years ago, people said, they thought this through, and they were like, maybe that's not such a good idea.
That's why we have to convert to Islamic finance. It'll be solved.
Then we'll be okay. So that's all switched to Islamic finance.
Yeah.
It's amazing what these guys, like, back in the day thought through. Our Federal Reserve bankers aren't. Anyway, any other thoughts about smart contracts, formal systems, Haskell, Agda, Idris? I hope I've inspired you to go and learn some of these incredibly superior languages. And if you'd like to get involved in working on this with us, we are open to new developers coming and joining the project. In theory, we are going to work with some researchers from NUS and NTU and I2R. In practice, I think we will leave them in the dust relatively quickly, but who knows?
Drag them along.
We'll drag them closer. No, like the universities actually have a lot of IP in informal methods. Just like getting it out of them is the challenge. So. Yep. Chapter 10, Crypt Key Semantics. Do you know who Crypt Key was? So all this stuff about like the modal calculus, really groundbreaking, really fundamental. Kripke did when he was about 19. True story.
He's still alive.
Yeah, he's like that young. So he wrote these two books when he was a teenager, and he basically invented the field of modal logic. that's all. I think it's time for dinner. Hope that was useful.
Okay.
Do come and talk to me.